conference or some order for that.
Yeah, I did. Yeah, we.
You would think that kind of gentle season it is. But today we're going to light the first candle on our Advent wreath. It's the candle of light. The church year begins. It's a holy season. In the past, originally it was a time of austerity and doom and sadness and revisit all your sins and repent, that kind of thing. Needless to say, we have veered off of that course just a little bit and to a time of almost commercial madness, but at the same time, it's a season of preparation, a holy season, a time when Christians prepare their minds and hearts to receive anew God's greatest gift. It seems odd in a well-lit room like this to say slowly the darkness fades with the lighting of one little candle. But it's the darkness of fear, the darkness of ignorance, the darkness of indifference that can begin to fade as the darkness of sin can fall away. The light that's to illumine our night is ahead beyond this light. In worship, prayer, and thanksgiving, we prepare ourselves. All Christendom this day marks the beginning of the Advent season, and almost all of them do it in this way. Lighting a candle is a sign of light, a sign of hope. The Son of God will come, and through him will know the Father. Light and love will indeed reign. It's interesting, this morning when the paper came, it was interesting for several reasons. First of all, it was really early, which it seldom is on Sundays for some reason. Secondly, in the paper, it was Donna's column, Soliloquy, and it's excellent, and if you don't get a paper, you should jolly well go out and buy one. It's worth it. But one quote, my whole life, she says, is sometimes like those dirty windows. Neglect and distraction can obscure the wider world. I put off the good deed, the kind word, and neighborly act until another day when it's more convenient. She was talking about planning to get the windows washed before the winter set in. We've been there, and who hasn't? And she said, of course, she missed it because it got cold, but then a warm day showed up, and it got done. And the cleanliness, the cleanness of the window enables us then to see what's really out there, see people more clearly, see the natural world around us more clearly. Hopefully, that's what Advent can be for us as we revisit the usual scriptures of Advent, and we let those shine on our pathway, let those things help clean our windows. Or just clean our eyes back away so we can really see what's important, see what needs to be done, and see our way to seeing that we get it done. So, Donna, I appreciate that. It's very, very good. And we have birthdays. Gordon Johnson on today, and Isaac this week. He's happy about that. I see the smile from here. Any other birthdays that we should take care of? So you gonna play happy birthday for yourself?
Yeah.
Or should we just let Lori do that and you can
stand up and take a bow?
Yeah, stand up. Okay, let's do happy birthday. Journey, they're calling it, back to Bethlehem. The announcement reads, bring your family and friends, enjoy the living nativity with live animals, hot chocolate, live, and I thought, live animals and live hot chocolate? Anyway, they're going to be doing this on the, on Saturday the 8th. And it sounds like it should be a lot of fun. So if you would like to do that, that'll happen next Saturday at between 5 and 7. And then on Sunday, they're having a Christmas bell choir concert at 2 o'clock, refreshments and all of that. And Naomi and Bob are going to be playing at 2:30. Yeah. Now, Naomi gave me all this information last week. The only thing I can remember was enjoy Naomi and Harp soon at First Methodist at Christmas, and Christmas at Faith. But Living Christmas Tree is today, last night also, and Naomi's playing at that. That's at 3 and 7 today. So a lot of things going on. Our people are involved, and that's a good thing. First Church would be happy that I did all that, I'm sure. United Methodist Women meet today right after worship. It's a potluck. If you didn't bring anything to pass, stick around anyway. There's always plenty to eat. And we'll probably have a few that will stay as guests as well. So, Harvest Festival gifts are being received through the end of this month, and they are going to Salvation Army and the Safe Harbor, right? Okay, we have plenty of time yet to get those in the spirit of the season. Also on the 9th, at St. Mark's Episcopal at 5:30, they're doing their annual lessons and carols service, and that's followed by a light supper. Cindy's in that. Anybody else from here? Okay. But that's always a good experience, I think. So lots of stuff going on, and you're invited to participate in those things. One last minute notice. This is today is the 200th anniversary of Silent Night. Now, is it true that that was played first on a guitar?
Actually, I'm going to do it on guitar.
I know, just a minute. We're going to surprise you with that one. But I was wondering if anybody out there knew if that was true, right? I heard that the organ in the church had broken okay. And it was written and then played on guitar. And so, in honor of the occasion, which fortunately Cindy reminded me of, we're going to have Bob play it on his mandolin.
Actually, I'm going to use the guitar, I think.
Guitar, okay. And we're going to sing Silent Night. And we might as well do that right now. That's at the number 239. We're just going to be a musical group like you wouldn't believe today. 239. You want to do all four verses? Sure. Well, the fourth verse will be in the full swing of it.
Thank you.
church, I think had German roots, didn't it?
Why didn't we sing that in German?
Oh, I don't know, Chad. You want to sing another verse in German?
Do it, do it.
Chad, you want to sing it to us? Yeah, I saw those being put out. I was going to say something, so thank you for bringing that up.
How much are they?
Free.
Can you afford free today?
Yeah.
Okay. No one's going to pay you to take them, but you can't have it for nothing. Right? So as you start down the stairway there, they're on your left-hand side of the table. Thanks, Art. Thanks for the calendars. That's an excellent thing.
The Episcopal calendar.
What? Oh, yeah. That would be kind of handy with an Episcopal calendar with all the colors.
And they're free there.
I used to have a little tiny calendar book. If anybody sees that, I really would love to. I'm looking for 5 months for that silly thing. It also tells you what colors you're supposed to be. The only color I do have with that one is seeing red because I don't know what happened to it, but that's my problem. But, I actually called the Methodist Publishing House and I said, do you think maybe there's an extra copy of 2018 laying around so I could at least kind of get caught up a little bit? And she said, well, we'll call you back. So they called me back and they didn't have any. I found that a little hard to believe, but I'm not going to malign the Methodist Publishing House. Okay. Let's stand, take a few moments to greet and welcome each other with this time of worship. Moving right along.
Yeah. Morning, Sharon.
Good to see you.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
Yeah.
You'd be surprised how many of them.
Oh,
yes.
Oh.
I got a word. Oh, well, thank you. I guess you're way right. That's okay.
You know, we should have had Christopher.
That would have been great, yeah. He should have sounded really
good. I can imagine you would want to get up.
You
would
have been microphone.
I know, wouldn't you love that?
Well, it's been an unusual way to start a service in our tradition, but it's certainly been a very pleasant one, an enlightening one, and a good way to begin our church here and the start of Advent. Our first hymn is 211, O Come Emmanuel, verses 1, 2, 6, and 7, I think.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah, you know, let's do what's on the sheet, because 1, 2, 3, and 4, because what's in the bullet isn't going to work. 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Oh, yeah, that was.
Yeah, that's the way it is in the hymnal, too, so. All right.
Oh,
powerful words. I find myself, when I listen to the news and read the paper and stuff, wishing that the signs that have gone before and the many varied ways people are worshiping God, that they might all be able to respond to God as they see God, in the way that song says, before the ruler's silent fall, all people on their mercy call, on thy mercy call. I don't know my way around a lot of religions, but I know a number of them, and it always distresses me when somebody who's really very intelligent, you know, years ago Charlie Rose was interviewing two Catholic priests, and he said, what does your God say about whatever it was? And we were taken aback, thinking, what do you mean, your God? I mean, God is God, and if God is called something other than God, God is still God. If we believe in one God, that's the God we're singing about. Before whom rulers ought silent fall. In humility and willingness to be obedient and caring and loving. And if Islamic people call God something different, or Asian people call God something different, God is one God. Let's take these next moments and spend them in prayer. Eternal God, in our gathering, we visit, we hear your word as it comes to us in song, as we're reminded of the anticipation of the ancients of the coming of your Son into the world. A sign of hope. An appropriate beacon to hold out even in our own time, which is also a time of darkness a lot of the time. We pray for those who have lost loved ones to death, be it through earthquake, quake, wind, or fire, through violence or through the natural movement that we make from birth through our lives to eventually the time when we move on to be with you through death. We thank you for the promises that you've given us, not just for this life, but for eternity. And for the hope that that gives those who are approaching that time, that they might move on in peace and joy and comfort. Those of us who are separated by these events experience loneliness and sometimes anger and sometimes fear. Help us find peace in these moments of darkness. Pray for healing for those who are ill, for those who are recovering from surgery, for those who are facing more treatment for various ailments. We offer our prayers asking for direction in our own lives, in the way we relate to other people and you. Oh God, your Son has shown light to the people in darkness. Rekindle that light in us this Advent, that this might be a time of spiritual preparation with its hallmark in real Christ-centered Christmas celebration. Our Father, who A deer head with a red light in it. somebody from the crowd goes, "Yo, Santa." It was just cool. Anyway, and many, many other floats, and a lot of fun. Last night, we had at least three fire trucks, a golf cart that was really cute, with like a sleigh, and three other floats. We got our stuff together, and we sat on our front porch, because that's where they start the things, out in front of our house. So we sat there, bundled up. It took us longer to get out and sit down than the parade last. But we still call it Christmas on Parade. But all day, there's supposed to be lots of things happening uptown, and it's a neat thing. It's gotten a lot smaller in the last few years. But one of the things we did was go down to the hardware store. They had goodies to eat, sandwiches and all that. Several places had really neat stuff, and so we picked out a bit, and then we went down there and looked around at things, and later in the afternoon, I went down and got a bunch of stuff, and I mean, it was a 20% off celebration, so of course you could do that. But I also discovered I had two fluorescent lights in the garage that were dying right before my eyes. Now, I replaced two a few weeks before, and it was not fun. Those things are 13 feet up in the air, and there's nothing to put a ladder on except what's 13 feet below it. So I put those in, and I bought two more lights, and I climbed up my ladder with great fear and trembling. And I think the fear came because the ladder kept kind of going like this, and that wasn't so much fun either. But I got the lights in with no problem, and the light shone, and the people of our house were glad. But it wasn't without fear and trepidation. Anyway, I went to that same hardware store when we were living there before. We had a blizzard, and I thought, this is the year I better buy a snowblower. So I was thinking, well, we're going to Aberdeen. I called, and Boyd Bloomer called up, and he says, "Don't look for one down here. There's no one that has them." He says, "I've looked, and they just don't have them." And this is about getting close to Thanksgiving. And so I checked around a few other places. No, nobody has any snowblowers. So we were going down to a Bible study at Langford, and went by the same hardware store, and there was a bright red snowblower. And I swung in, and I said, "We're going to be late, but I don't care." So we bought this snowblower, paid a lot more than we should have. It had little tracks on it, you know, and this was cool. And they delivered it to our house. I always thought that was really neat, except those little tracks, if you got into too heavy snow, instead of pushing the snow or blowing the snow, it wanted to crawl up over the snow. And I just packed it down. But it worked pretty well for a few years, and I sold it to a friend and moved on to something else. But when I went to buy one, before I called Boyd, I went to that hardware store to buy a snowblower, and they didn't have any in then. And I'd seen them in the ad, and they said they didn't have it. I don't know where this one came from that I did get, but I said, "Could I order one?" And they said, "No." And I said, "Why not?" "Well, the factory makes lawnmowers in November. You order snowblowers in July." Kind of like I wanted to buy a short sleeve shirt at Penny's or Uber's in December. We don't have short sleeve shirts. We have those in the summertime. How about for people who wear a short sleeve white shirt under a sweater? Yeah, that's your problem. It worked out well. I'm not sure where that snowblower came from that we got, but it was good. I promised myself when I turned 50 I was not going to throw snow anymore, so I was going to buy a snowblower. But it was a real job finding it and actually getting into selling one. Snowblowers are made in July. Ads and decorations for Halloween go up in August. Thanksgiving things come out in September. And sometimes the Halloween stuff comes out even earlier. And Christmas stuff comes out in October, if not earlier. "We have to be ready," say the merchants. And they do. Still, it would be nice if they could wait just a little longer. All the trees, the live trees, the real trees, that were brought into this hardware store in Britain, they must have had 50 of them. There's about 8 left. They were gone by yesterday, most of them. Nice trees, and they really didn't, they weren't as expensive as you might think, but we keep thinking if you got an artificial tree, it goes forever. Well, we got one that was pre-lit last year. Plugged it in. We had this many lights that came on. So I went through and I checked, I tested, looked for empty sockets and things. Nothing. So I pulled off all those dead lights and dragged out some cheap old lights and put colored lights on the tree. Every year about this time, sermons are preached and letters written to newspapers condemning the rush and merchandising of Christmas, the crass materialism of it all. But we're all a part of it. It's amazing to me every Sunday morning when I drive into town, Menards parking lot is about half full. This morning was a little lighter. It's a cold morning. Anyway, and Walmart is about half full. I know some people don't even have time to shop, but it's just interesting how the merchandising goes. It's all the time, and we're all a part of it. One year after a Thanksgiving Eve service, a lady from another church said, "You know, I almost called to tell you how disappointed I was that you, a pastor, would have your Christmas decorations out before Thanksgiving." But then she said, "Then somebody said, told me your family is home and you're doing Thanksgiving and Christmas with them." And I thought to myself, "Well, thank you very much. Nice you approve." I mean, what difference does it make? I mean, you could do a lot worse things early than Christmas. I notice we don't rush into paying our taxes 3 months early, usually. Well, some do, but. Christians aren't somewhere outside the world. We're part of a cultural Christmas and a religious Christmas, an intertwining of the secular and the sacred. We're both materialists and spiritualists. When I was very young, I could hardly wait for Christmas to come. The days just seemed to drag. Still, had they all flown as quickly as I would have them go, the things that happened while I was waiting wouldn't have happened. There wouldn't have been time. As it was, there was the baking of cookies and breads. Now, I've never baked a cookie or a loaf of bread in my life. But my mother did, and my friends' mothers did. And man, the aroma is just unbelievable. And the taste, the baking, the shopping, the Christmas music. I love Christmas music. We've already watched most of the Hallmark Christmas movies, I think. And there's still some to come that we haven't seen. And you could say they're schmaltzy, but they do have a nice story, they have a nice ending, they usually, they're like the old westerns, you know, everything ends happily ever after. Only difference in the Christmas programs, the hero doesn't ride off on his horse. Usually, the boy and the girl get together, or whatever. Happy ending. We always had the program practices at church and school, the cards in the mail, and the parties, the decorating of the tree in the house, and the reading of Christmas storybooks. I grew to love not only the day and not only its significance to faith, but the season itself. And the joyful change it manages to create in most of the people most of the time. It was beautiful. It's still beautiful. But it all happened while we were waiting for Christmas Day. We'd go down to Grandpa and Grandma Keenan's in Huron. Itself, an endless journey. 100 miles from Watertown to Huron. Endless. We'd get down there and the tree was up and the food was always smelled good. The family would gather and I could not paid $100 for something, gone to sleep, a good go-to-sleep pill. Besides, they didn't give kids those things. But Grandma Keenan came around one night and she said, "You seem to be having trouble going to sleep." "Oh yeah." "Well, I'll give you a sleeping pill." So she gave me a half an aspirin. I didn't know until a while later, but that's what it was. I was all like a light. Power of suggestion. Without the waiting and the fullness of preparation activity, the day itself would not have been nearly so wonderful. I still feel it. I could say, I almost smell the cookies, but why wouldn't I? Today we had three sets of cookies show up at the coffee group. Two birthdays and cheesecake and all that stuff. So of course I can smell the cookies and the bread that bake in the season. It's just, it's a neat thing. So I am not going to disparage the early marketing. I'm not going to disparage the cultural stuff of Christmas. There's a beauty to it. There is a thing that seeks to bring out the best in us. First Sunday of Advent. Advent is a Latin word which means to come. The church uses this word to label these 4 weeks before Christmas and encourages us to use these weeks to prepare spiritually. Try to understand why Christmas is important. So while we wait, we don't just wait, we prepare ourselves. I used to lament by the end of November that I wasn't totally prepared for Advent and Christmas. To be that ready, I think, means to have made the Advent time an end in itself, instead of recognizing that it's a working time, a growing time, a preparation experience, a tool with which we might better grasp the events of Christmas. A time to learn new things about it, perhaps. This last week I've been looking for pipe clamps. I bought three beams, 8 feet long, 6 inches square, to replace a log in the front of our house that has our name in it, mostly, yet, which has been rotting away. And I want galvanized letters to put our name on these beams. And to keep them upright and to keep them hooked together, I devised this lavish plan to put a long bolt through them and screw them together and stick them in the ground. So I was looking for pipe clamps, because these beams, you know, I looked at them, tried to get the perfect beam. So I got them home, laid them side by side, you know. If this end is square, the other end is far apart. So I've been looking for pipe clamps. "Oh, I'm sorry, we had some of those, but we sold them. We didn't know anybody wanted them." Somebody did, they bought them. Anyway. So we were in this little hardware store, and Kathy saw these canvas straps that truckers use to tie down their loads. She said, "Wouldn't these work?" I said, "You know they might." So we bought some of those, and I had one at home, and I wrapped those around those beams and cracked them tight, and it worked. And I think it worked better than the clamps would have worked, because this thing ties the whole thing together. And they should come apart, they're going to be all over the garage. I mean, there's a lot of tension in those things. But I got part of them done. But that was a whole new learning experience. Thanks to Kathy, who is not a woodworker or a mechanic or any of those things, but just has an eye to see these things that really work. We live in this world. We're a part of the semi-Christian observance of the turn of the year. We celebrate it with joy and that was one of those joyful insights that she had that made that part of my day. Church folk prepare for Advent and Christmas in late summer, early fall, to be ready with special events for the season. You know, there are people in charge of music that get this stuff in order ahead of time. And the bigger the church, the farther ahead they plan. Living Christmas tree wasn't done last week. Planned for a long time. And the events up at St. Mark's as well. Be ready for the special events of the season. How is our preparation any more sacred than that of the merchants? In the early days of the church, many pagan celebrations were popular throughout the Roman Empire. Among the most popular was a festival of winter solstice, which marked the time when the wintry days began to lengthen again into more hours of sunlight. This festival was marked by good eating and an exchange of gifts. The merchant's carnival is not wholly a secular fiesta, and the world's advent hustle and bustle is not wholly pagan. For that matter, it's possible that not everything in the church's preparations is wholly holy, pure and Christian. I've been in church situations sometimes where the push for the season and the perfection expected is almost enough to drive you crazy. A close to being unholy experience. So, I've made it a policy of saying to myself, enough bashing and whining, merchant bashing and whining, instead of blaming someone else for our inability or unwillingness to keep the secular and the sacred straight, let's use the time instead to prepare ourselves room in our hearts and in our lives this season and all year for the Christ and his influence on our priorities, his light on our paths, light which can, if we let it, if we use it, empower us to walk in his way wherever or whatever our tasks. One thing we've noticed is when we go into a store or a shop or something is the difference in the way people meet the public. We walked into a restaurant the Hunter's restaurant in Britain last week, middle of the day, and this little waitress jumped up from her table and she says, "Oh, I'm so glad to see you." We had no idea who she was. She says, I've only had two tables all day. And she practically hugged us. So now that is a neat way to get greeted when you walk into a place where you're going to spend your money. Made our day. And there are other people out there that do that. And unfortunately, the ones that don't, that's too bad because they're missing a great deal of the fun of relating to people in the spirit of the season and in the spirit of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Oh God, help us as we hear the story that we already know to absorb it and to decide how to live it in our lives and encourage others to live it in theirs. Amen. Our hymn is 213. Lift up your heads. Let's lift up ourselves and sing that. Thank you. Consecrate us, O Lord, as we remember Jesus and fulfill his commandment to eat this meal in remembrance of him. For in the night that he was betrayed, he gave himself up for us, took bread, gave thanks to you, and broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. And when the meal was over, he took the cup and gave thanks to you for it, and gave it to them, saying, This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this in remembrance of me. Give us confidence, O God, that we ourselves might know you and know each other better in the breaking of bread and in the sharing of the cup. Holy Spirit of God, sanctify this food for our salvation and unite us through this bread and unfermented juice of the grape into one body with him who loved us and gave himself up for us, namely Jesus, who was Christ, and who was praised, pointed not to himself, but rather led us to worship and praise only you. In his name we continue in prayer together. O God, though unworthy to share this sacrament, may we walk in new life and dwell in Jesus and he in us. Amen. This is always the case when we share this sacrament. Whoever is here is welcome to come forward and receive it. But this is not the Methodist table, it's the table of our Lord. And he offered it to all of his disciples, all of whom are not necessarily perfect. So it's offered to all of us. Come, share this meal. for sending your Son to us with your love. We rejoice in his presence. Amen. Our hymn is 715, Rejoice, the Lord is King. Let's stand for that.
Delta name, but evidently.
Yeah, they're. That's
gotta go home. I gotta do some hay work.
I'll have my.
So not today. Sorry. Boy, you're asking for a lot. That's what you were.
All right, let's go down.
No, I think I will.